Then I saw a lamb, looking as if it had been slain, standing at the center of the throne, encircled by the four living creatures and the elders. The lamb had seven horns and seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God sent out into all the earth. And when he had taken it, the four living creatures and the 24 elders fell down before the lamb. Each one had a harp, and they were holding golden bowls full of incense, which are the prayers of God's people. For the lamb at the center of the throne will be their shepherd. He will lead them to springs of living water, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Have you ever done things and you say to yourself, oh, I don't need to do that, but you do it anyway, just in case. Just in case, every week I print a hard copy of the sermon. I don't need to because it's on my iPad. My iPad dropped dead last night. Isn't it a good thing after all these years I've kept that practice? I keep telling myself, oh, stop printing these out, you'll never need it. Sometimes, the pinnacle essence of this day calls you and I to acknowledge that we are spiritual infants. Even giants like Billy Graham or Pope Francis or any other pastor or theologian we may be aware of are tied to this same level of comprehension. So be of good cheer. We're all in good company. One famous theologian who had written scores of books on understanding God was asked on his deathbed to recount the most significant theological understanding he ever attained. Looking up from the bed, he said to the person, in all the years, through all the academic and language studies that I have done about God, the greatest lesson I have ever learned is this. Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. No matter how much you and I have learned, experienced, answered, or known through private or public moments of epiphany and spiritual awakenings, each and every one of us are in our spiritual infancy. And that is one of the things that Easter is all about. Easter Sunday says to the world, no matter how much you think you know, you haven't got a clue. The resurrection narrative that Christian churches faithfully recount at least once a year says to all of humanity, without faith, you will live totally clueless. But this is the difference between us, isn't it? As people of faith, we have a clue. We don't have all the answers. We don't have all the formulas or physics of the Easter narrative worked out. But within every individual who is part of the Christian faith community, we do have that little spark of energy that produces faith for some. And for some, it produces enough faith that we are drawn like a magnet to what Jesus called the truth and the life. Our scripture reading this morning is a little unusual for Easter. Most of us are quite comfortable hearing of the women at the tomb, or those seemingly faithless disciples who momentarily forget 3 years of Christ's teachings. If you missed our gathering in the memorial garden this morning, I'm sure we'll cover it again next year, if not sometime sooner. But the essence of Easter is more than the Easter narrative. And that draws us to our scripture reading today. Martin Luther, when writing his commentaries on the Bible, said he thought the entire book of Revelation ought to be totally excluded from scripture. He thought it too confusing for the common masses who needed to focus more on faith and grace in their everyday living than in scenes of the heavenly throne room. My hunch is John Wesley probably wouldn't have argued with him too much on that point as well. But this is the scripture that you and I have been handed today. We need to hopefully do something with it. I've only served one parish in my life that took to the task of studying the book of Revelation, and I will confess, for them it was a daunting task. But we completed it. Took more than 2 years, but we completed it.
Wow.
And our scripture reading today opens with the risen Christ at the center of the throne room. And it speaks of four living creatures that are there. But if you study the book, you will discover the hall is actually much more crowded than that. It's much like a homecoming. It's a day of celebration. The prophet John, at the time of his writing, sitting in prison on that Isle of Patmos, is given a special insight into the expanse of God's kingdom. But what you and I need to understand is that the vision shared is only a sliver. It is only like looking through a very tiny keyhole into the expanse of what God has waiting for you and I on the other side. It's a peek, which makes sense to those that know the Old Testament prophecies related not only to the Messiah, but to the entire history of God's chosen people. If you will, consider it this way. If I brought you with me into a scientific lab and began speaking to other people that were already there about elements and formulas and equations and theories and suppositions related to known quantum foundational assumptions, you might stand there and think to yourself, what on earth is he talking about? But to others in the lab, the dialogue would seem perfectly normal and make logical sense. That's how the book of Revelation is to many of us. But no matter how much we don't know, it's vitally important that we do know something about this scene. For this scene reveals truths known to God's chosen people, dynamics about our hope, our faith, and our future. This passage is a revelation of assurance that what we once hoped for is now already a reality. When new members come into any Christian church, like we will witness next week, they are asked the foundational questions of faith. Do you believe? It's a question that asks, with what you know, are you comfortable placing all your hope, faith, and assurance in this man that we call Jesus of Nazareth? The answer that we have all given at one time or another, if we're a member of any Christian church, is that affirmation of our belief. Our passage today tells us that we can know the validity of that hope and of that promise in the here and now, and not somewhere in the distance in the sweet by and by. For in this text, we have been given a keyhole view that provides us a first-hand glimpse of that once promised assurance. In the second chapter of Luke's account of the early church, we are told, in the last days, God says, I will pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your young men will see visions. Your old men will dream dreams. The prophet John is just one of many who will experience this spiritual presence and insight of Christ's revelation through thought, through visions, through dreams, and through insight. Since the ascension of Christ, the Christian church has been living in the end times, the last days. But then remember, we're told in 2 Peter, a day to the Lord is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years are like a day. God's time is not measured in length as you and I measure time, but rather God's time is measured in fullness. And in the fullness of humanity's time, the Word tells us that God sent His Son, who proclaimed God's truths and then returned to His home, offering to us the extended invitation to receive and to one day join him. You see, the essence of Christ did not end on a cross at Calvary. The essence of Christ did not end in that moment of his ascension. Our passage today reminds us of the glory of Easter. For the essence of Christ lives on in the heavens and in the hearts of those who would receive him. And if we think that little thin sliver, glimmer of information shared with us by the prophet John is more than we can handle, keep this in mind. John is only revealing to us a very small portion of that throne room. Think about it. Have you ever looked through a keyhole? Did you see the entire room? You only saw this much. And when we look at the prophecies of the Bible, they tell us this much. But they also, in not telling us, tell us there is so much more yet to be seen, to experience, and to live. Can you imagine what encompasses Jesus' words when he says to his disciples, "In my Father's house"? If Easter revealed anything to humanity, it reveals to us the past, the present, and the ever-expanding presence of God's universe is more than we can ever comprehend, at least in the here and now. 1 Corinthians 13 tells us, "For now we see only a reflection as in a mirror, but then we shall see face to face. Now I know only in part, but then I shall know fully, even as I am fully known." You know, friends, just as an infant can only know what is in their immediate surroundings and still not be sure of all their implications, you and I are spiritual infants. You and I are surrounded by revelations that we hardly see or identify or recognize. But if we can only embrace one element of our elusive future, let it be this: the vision that we have seen. For the word tells us Jesus, the Lamb that was slain, now reigns. And as the old song says, "And he shall reign forever and ever." Question or fear not the things that we cannot know. Embrace that which is given to us this day. For your comfort, for your faith, for your assurance, but most importantly, for our future. Let us pray. Our Lord, so often when we embrace Easter, we remember only a scene in a garden. We remember the women, we remember the angels, we remember the disciples, we remember Mary, but we sometimes fail to understand that Easter is that pivotal moment that opens the doors of heaven, but just a crack, that we might begin to see that which you hold for us. Help us on this side of eternity to be faithful to your call, that when that day comes, we might truly celebrate with all the saints of heaven and join their unending hymn in saying, "Worthy is the Lamb that was slain." Enable us to know the Easter story in our heart this day. Equip and enable us to share those words with the world about us. For we ask these things in Christ's name. And all of God's people said,
Amen.
If you are able, I invite you to stand with me for our closing hymn, number 150.